St. Charles Borromeo said, if we wish to make any progress in the service of God, we must begin every day of our life with new eagerness. It is with this eagerness, while attending Chaminade High School, our next guest, Father Lachlan Cameron often felt the Lord calling him to the service of Christ in the church. He was ordained a priest in 2008 and is currently the chaplain at Stony Brook University. Today he will share with us his vocation story here on It's a Wonderful Life. Welcome back to It's a Wonderful Life. We're joined today by Father Lachlan Cameron, the chaplain at Stony Brook University. Father Lachlan, welcome to the show.
Father Joe, thanks for having me.
Father Lachlan, we've journeyed pretty much throughout our time in the seminary and as priests, and you have just an incredible story of growing up and family and like parents coming over here to the U.S. from Scotland. Maybe you could speak a little bit about growing up and also where that vocation started.
Yeah, sure. So I was born in 1981. My dad's Scottish, my mom's American. They were married in 72, moved to Scotland, and my sister, my two brothers, and I were all born there. When they came across in the beginning of 84, I was just about 3 years old. So growing up here in Belrose, Floral Park, that area, growing up in Holy Spirit Parish, but growing up always with this interesting background with right. My dad being Scottish and an immigrant story, landing here, and my dad working two jobs pretty much all the time I was growing up to provide for the family, support the family. My mom in time and working as well. So just their example, always at the fore in my life of hard work and sacrifice. And I always, especially now, I'm 10 years a priest, looking back and I see the role of my parents in my vocation, mm-hmm. like more and more, and the sacrificial love that they have. I see my vocation, the beginnings of it, rooted in that example that they gave to me. The love that they have for each other, the sacrifices they've made for each other, the challenges of married life that they've lived, and the sacrifices they made for my sister, my brothers, and for me growing up. And I think I saw the value of sacrificial love in their marriage. And any vocation is sacrificial. So therefore, when the Lord puts the stirring in my heart of priesthood, it makes sense. I was instilled about having a good education and all sorts of things for life, without a doubt, from my parents. But knowing always that was a priority, making sure that I lived that life of sacrifice.
Was there any involvement in the parish? So you're solid at home with mom and dad, brothers and sister. Were there any priests that influenced you, involved in the parish, that kind of thing?
Yeah, so I was blessed, able to go to Holy Spirit School growing up. That was my my home parish. And Monsignor John Heinlein, who's a retired priest of the diocese, he was the pastor back then. And he always had a lot of priests in the house. I think he just had a generous way about him where, we probably had a few more guys than we were warranted by numbers. But it was just a big house of priests. And in the parish, as an altar server, being around the school, priests that were involved. And always blessed to be able to, to see priests, say off the altar, if it was in the sacristy as an altar server, if it was in the schoolyard during recess or something like that, witness of them outside of, their priestly liturgical vesture. And my parents were friendly with Monsignor John, Monsignor Heinlein, so he would stop by every so often for a cup of tea and a piece of cake or something, and just again seeing him outside of the church setting. So that example, given to me by the priest in the parish. I was also blessed to have the Dominican sisters at Holy Spirit. Sister Angela Lavecchi was the school principal, Sister Rose Michael, Sister Grace Kenneth, a whole bunch of really powerful women, and their example of service and dedication, something shown to me in my my early formation years. And from Holy Spirit, I went on to Chaminade, and there the Marianists, the priests and brothers, powerful example to me, so many of them. And I think I always say they made a vocation seem more attainable to me because they were younger. So here are young brothers, young priests that are giving themselves to the Lord and in their community life and their personal life, just showing to me that God does call. So what my parents had kind of shown quietly, what they had, in a quiet way also encouraged us, my sister, my brothers, and I all to be open to vocation all of a sudden, after the priest example at Holy Spirit, the Dominican example, the Marian has come along, and it's the beginnings of the vocation really start to kick off there as far as God calling me to serve in some way.
Open an experience of like college, not feeling necessarily called to jump into the seminary right there, kind of a regular college experience.
Yeah, I really discerned vocation the end of junior year, senior year of high school, and I thought I was going to be entering a college, seminary program. I went all the way through application process. I took the psychological examinations, all those things, and I didn't fail. Don't worry.
Okay.
but I just had a sense. I think it was like maybe end of March, beginning of April, that this wasn't for me. And at that point, I had kind of looked at the colleges that the seminary program would use. And I had been accepted to those, and I opted not to go to the college program, but instead just to reside at home and go to school, kind of as a normal student, a commuter student. So like my sister and one of my brothers did, I went to St. John's, local boy, and commuting back and forth, getting involved in college life there, and working and just having a kind of a normal experience. The stirrings of the vocation, were still there, and toward the end of my college years, there's a new vocation director, Father Tom Coogan. He reached out, and we caught up a few times. And just kind of the way it happened, I had studied math and philosophy. I was coming to the end of my time. I had the philosophy credits needed to begin theology formation. And Bishop Murphy was, good enough to let me enter immediately into theology studies. And so I ended up not going to pre-theology or a college seminary program.
Lucky you.
Yeah. And then in 2003, I arrive in Huntington as a first theologian, and you, Father Joe, are there in theology.
Yeah, that was a blessed time. We had a really good, really healthy house. We did, like, as you said, something like that normal experience that people always wonder, like, do you just go up there and be bookworms? But that was not necessarily ours.
No, I mean, we were blessed because your class was like 12 or so. Right. We were like 20, 25, all together at that time. And it just made for some football games, basketball, indoor soccer.
Yes, the international flavor there.
Some sports. The faculty, too, we're now Bishop Massa, now Bishop Penning, the alleys, the rivalries on the alleys.
That was a lot of fun. That was a lot of fun.
It's a good time.
It was great. So then you're ordained, you go to St. Rose of Lima, your first parish, and tell us a little bit about that. What was your first powerful priestly experience when you went to St. Rose?
So I was there in 2008, and a newbie. I said I went from like schooling to more schooling.
Right.
And I worked along the way, but I didn't work in the world. And I was blessed to arrive there and to be surrounded by an incredible staff of lay people. Father Ken Zach, the newly appointed pastor, Monsignor Dan Hurley, was still in residence at that point, retired. It was a big house as well. It's a big parish, so a lot of priests, different experiences of priesthood that I'm seeing. And really, I look back, and they were just formative years, and the people were incredibly kind to me. as you're learning how to, you've gone through the practicals of, a funeral or a wedding, but here they are in play with real people. And all along the way, people just, very kind and informing me. And the professionalism of the staff, I see that as, just a tremendous gift, kind of their first office that you're working in.
That's right.
And you have people that are very competent and, wanting what's best for you. They love the church, they love the priesthood, and they're kind in helping you to be the best you can be in it all. So.
It's like a secondary seminary.
Yeah, exactly.
Paul, like you, you went from St. Rose, and you had some special ministry, did some study, but then you did initially early on, and then now back again, you did some college campus ministry. You were at Adelphi, but now there's a new program that Bishop Barris has put forth. It's a program called With Focus, and you as in many ways directing everything out there at Stony Brook University. Can you speak about what's going on out there?
Yeah, so this past summer, the summer of 2018, I was appointed chaplain at Stony Brook University, and full-time which is a little different from the model that the diocese has been following in recent years,
right,
to put a priest full-time into the work. So I'm there. That's my full-time assignment. And with that, the bishops invited in this group, as you said, FOCUS, the Fellowship of Catholic University Students. They're a group that's been around about 20 years. They're recent college grads who feel the call to serve, to do missionary work, not in a far-flung place, but on a college campus. And so they're in about 200 campuses around the country. And Stony Brook's the first time they're present within the Diocese of Rockville Center.
Awesome.
And the New York area, they're also at NYU, at Columbia, at West Point. So, it's just a beautiful kind of lining up of the bishop's desire, the diocesan desire to have FOCUS present, and as well FOCUS's desire to be, within the SUNY system, to be at Stony Brook. So, a
different schedule than like what the parish priest would have, the 9 o'clock mass.
Oh yeah.
Now it's why don't you speak a little bit about that?
Sure. So in these months, it's kind of leaving early and getting back late. Unlike a parish where in the midst of the day you could go across to your rooms and if you have some downtime, be able to read for an hour or take something like that. I'm just kind of at the university, so it can be long days, 12, 13 hours sometimes on campus. But that presence, as you know, is so important. No matter where we are as priests, if we're present and available to people, that's where the Lord is able to do work. So, Mass is midday for us during the week. And then it's just kind of, being there for when students are, have breaks from classes or looking to catch up, speak, and availability to really make yourself present according to their schedule. So confessions, happening as it suits the students.
Sometimes our young folks get a bad rap about they're falling away. They're all these, they're not really connected to faith. What's been your experience with the college students, especially at a place like Stony Brook?
Yeah, so a secular school, a state school, and in the midst of that, you have a whole variety of students coming forth. You have kids that have been brought up in good, solid Catholic homes. The faith's been passed on to them, and they're taking ownership of it themselves in these college years. And they just make themselves present and live the faith. And then others who are questioning and finding their way. So it's a mix, but there's a lot of hope. We had a Mass this past Sunday night, about 120 present at the Mass. And the priest, a visitor who came in to say the Mass, was blown away. And sometimes I can take that for granted, or I can look for another 25 or 50 to show up, forgetful that the Lord's doing good things. Of course, we're looking for growth. We're looking for more to be receptive to the good news as it hits them. But at the same time, a lot of good things happening. The FOCUS missionaries I'm with, their primary vehicle for interacting with students are small groups, Bible studies that they run, and there's a professed atheist who's in a Bible study now, a couple of Protestants that are just interested in looking. So there are certainly Catholics that are involved, but it just shows me that in the wider, campus setting, if you're willing to speak to someone of Christ, because of who he is, God, people will generally respond. And it's not always negative as people might think.
Awesome. Yeah. The life of a disciple, it's the life of a missionary, to respond where God calls. As well, on the journey of the priesthood, we must do the same. Father Lachlan Cameron has responded, whether it be in the parish or on the campus. As always, when we respond not only to what the bishop says, but what God calls us to, we will always live a wonderful life. Thanks for being with us today. As Catholics responding to the challenge of Bishop Barris to encourage dramatic missionary growth in the diocese, we use all forms of media in promoting the gospel, including television and social media. If you want to know more about any of the priests we featured here or have any questions or comments, you can email us at vocations@drvc.org, or you can visit our website at acalltoholiness.com. See you next time right here on It's a Wonderful Life.